online worship service. I know we can't meet in person right now because of the health crisis that's going on in our nation, but we can still gather together for worship. So let's begin with our opening song, Here I Am to Worship. Gracious Heavenly Father, I know that we cannot join together in person, and yet where two or three are gathered in the name of Jesus, there He is among us. And that is why we are so thankful that we get together online, Lord. We get to gather in Your name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We are so thankful for Your goodness, Your love and Your mercy, especially during these trying times, and especially during these times, Lord, we lift up to You that so often we have only thought of ourselves. So often we have only thought about how am I going to fare through all of this. We haven't really thought about other people. We've maybe thought about them, but instead, we thought about ourselves first above others' needs. And Lord, we know that this is sinful. We know that we look to be served rather than to serve. And that's why, Lord, we're going to lift that up to You right now. We're going to confess it to You right now, Lord. We're going to confess our sin, all our sin, Lord. And we're going to lay it at the foot of the cross of Jesus Christ. So we're going to lift up what's on our hearts right now. Yes, Lord, we lift it up. We lift it up in the name of Jesus, trusting in his mercy to us and his grace. Amen. Well, brothers and sisters in Christ, upon this, your confession of sin, I offer you good news, wonderful news. Jesus, he came to serve you, to give you his grace and his mercy, to give you his life at the cross, that all of your sin has been taken away. It's been removed. It's been removed, and you have been given a new heart and a new life in him. And now you get to serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness. So this is the good news that St. John's has called me to announce to you. And in the stead of Jesus Christ, and by his command, and with his promise, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Yes, it was at the cross that the love of God in Jesus Christ was poured out for us with his blood, his lifeblood, so that we could have life and be set free. So let's sing his praises at this time.
Thank you.
welcome everyone. Welcome to the 505. Yes, this is online. I hope everyone is staying healthy and staying home now and staying focused on Jesus. Thank you to everyone that all our musicians and our sound people and audiovisual that put this all together. You know, David and Chad and Madeline and Cam. So thankful for all your musical talent during this time, and thankful for Melissa and Owen, who is running the camera and the slides. Just so super thankful, and thankful for all of you. Thankful for all of your prayers during this time. Thankful for all of you stepping up to help, but also thankful that you're taking this pandemic seriously. And we are too here at St. John's. In the coming days and weeks, during this stay-at-home time, and also just, you know, practicing the social distancing and the personal hygiene, we are going to keep you updated via electronic means, email, and our Facebook page. And, you know, hopefully also we're going to be looking at some different options, online options for, say, Bible studies and small groups to use. I know I've already heard of some who were even using, you know, like conference calling phones for those who don't have email or internet. So great job, everyone. And we're continuing our series, Red Letter Challenge. And, you know, today we're going to be looking at serving. Today we're going to be looking at how important it is to be served by our Lord Jesus Christ and also to serve others in His name. And so the text that we're going to be reading, our red letters from Jesus, this comes from Matthew chapter 20, and we're going to be reading verses 20 through 28. If you have a Bible at home, or if you're online and you want to look it up at Bible Gateway, we're reading the English Standard Version of this. So this is God's word for you. Then the mother of the sons of Zebedee came up to him with her sons. And kneeling before him, she asked him for something. And he said to her, "What do you want?" She said to him, "Say that these two sons of mine are to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, in your kingdom." Jesus answered, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I am to drink?" They said to him, "We are able." He said to them, "You will drink my cup, but to sit at my right hand and at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared by my Father." And when the 10 heard it, they were indignant at the two brothers. But Jesus called them to him and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. It shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be your slave, even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, to give his life as a ransom for many." This is God's word for us. Will you pray with me? Gracious Heavenly Father, so thankful again that we get to hear your word, and we get to receive your word of grace and mercy in Jesus Christ, Lord. And sometimes these words are challenging, but they're also filled with good news of what Jesus does for us. So may these words that we hear, may they sink deep into our hearts and flow out into our lives. And we ask this in the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Well, much grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. So we have been doing this red letter challenge for Lent. We've been looking about how we're not just supposed to hear the words of Jesus, but we're actually supposed to be doing the words of Jesus. And as we may recall, we have five kind of building blocks built upon the foundation of Jesus, of which we are following following literally the red letters of Jesus. And, you know, we had being with Jesus, and then we had forgiving, being forgiven and then forgiving others. And this week is a week of serving. Now, even as Jesus calls us to serve, there's a question that we have to ask ourselves. Do you like to serve? Well, to kind of help you with that question, I thought I would show you a painting, an image. This is by Ford Madox Brown. And this is probably a familiar image, a familiar look here. This is Jesus washing Peter's feet. Jesus did this on the night that he was betrayed, the night he instituted the Lord's Supper. It was the night before he went to the cross. Before he did that, he sat down and stooped down and washed the disciples' feet. Now, the reason I bring this picture up is, well, where do you see yourself in this picture? Well, I'm sure many times you see yourself as Jesus here. Yeah, there are times that you serve people. There are times that you wash the feet of people in many, many ways. There's times you've helped out people, times that you've done work that has benefited people. Yeah. But I'll tell you what, more often than not, we find ourselves in Peter's place. We want to be served. We want others to wash our feet. We want others to come to us and serve us. And as much as we maybe appreciate that service, here's the thing. We want other people to serve us, to make us great, to lift us high up. And the thing is that's a heart and that attitude of being served can even show up when you're serving. I mean, yes, you and I definitely serve others, but how many times are we actually liking serving others? How many times do we actually serve others and yet it's with a heart that we want to be served, we want to be made great? How many times have you helped someone in need and thought, you know what? I'll do it, but only if it makes me look good, only if people give me praise because of it. Oh yeah, we can serve. We can look like we are serving others, and it's great. But God sees our hearts, and he sees that we're only doing this with a heart of self-serving. And how many times have we failed to serve others because we only want to be served? Oh yeah. We may want to serve sometimes, but more often than not, we want to be served by others. And you know, this is what was happening in our text when James and John and their mother, they came up to Jesus as they were going to Jerusalem. Now, the thing about this is that they were going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was teaching his disciples. He was preparing them for what was going to happen. And he warned them once, and then twice, and then a third time, right before this. He said, "We're going up to Jerusalem, and I'm going to be handed over to the hands of the chief priests and the scribes, and they're going to beat me and mock me, and then they're going to crucify me and kill me, and after 3 days I'm going to rise again." And it's in this context that James and John and their mother, they come up to Jesus and they pretty much say, "You know what, Jesus? Sounds great. You're going to establish your kingdom. I want you to do something. What do you want me to do for you?" "Well, I want you to actually take my two sons, James and John, I want you to put them in the places of honor one on your right and one on your left. That's what they wanted. They wanted to just sit there at the table while Jesus washed their feet, made them great. They were saying, serve me, make me great in your kingdom, Jesus. And when the other 10 heard it, oh man, they were mad. But not because James and John were doing something wrong here. No. Because they wanted all that glory and greatness for themselves. So there you have it. All the disciples sitting around the table and Jesus washing their feet, all seeking to be served, all seeking greatness. And Jesus holds up his hands. He's like, okay, wait a minute, guys. Hold on a second here. I have something that I have to tell you that's very important. You see, becoming great in my kingdom is not being served. It's not other people lifting you high and making you great. Actually, it's becoming a servant. Yes, someone who actually serves other people. It's becoming a slave of everyone, a slave whose entire existence depends upon the needs of others, who cannot help but serve others. And why is it this way in my kingdom? Because even the Son of Man, God in the flesh, me, I did not come to be served, but to serve. I came to serve. And yes, washing your feet was one of the ways I served you. But think about it. Ever since I've come, this is all I've been doing, is serving others. You know, I've been opening the eyes of those who are blind. I have been giving those who are deaf, they can now hear. Those who are lame, they can now get up and walk. I have touched those with leprosy and I've healed them. I have cast out demons from people. I have served them. But even more than that, I have preached the good news of the kingdom to everyone. I have preached comfort to people. I have said, take heart, your faith has made you well. I have said, little girl, rise up from the dead. And I have said, take heart, your sin is forgiven. But all of this serving here? All of this serving is pointing toward the greatest service that I will give to everyone, giving my life as a ransom for many. You see, at the cross, I humbled myself. I took on the form of a servant, and I gave my life for sinners, those who were only thinking of themselves, those who were only thinking of being served and being great. But through my serving, through my ransom, through my death, I have set them free. And I hope you realize, brothers and sisters, that at this point, Jesus is not just speaking to the 12. He's speaking to you and to me. Jesus serves you by giving you his life as a ransom. When you were enslaved, when I was enslaved with selfish, self-serving sinfulness. Yeah, we were slaves to that sinfulness. We were only thinking of ourselves. We were only thinking of one, you know,
looking out for number one. We were only thinking about being served. And that brought God's wrath upon us, producing death in us. But that's when Jesus, he gave payment for that. He paid for it all. He paid for all of your sin at the cross. He gave his very life for you so that you can be set free. Set free from sin. Set free from death. And then he gives you a new heart and a new life in him. That's Jesus serving you. But you know what? I want you to think how Jesus is still serving, even now. Oh yeah, this was Jesus serving his disciples, serving them before he went to the cross. But if you look at this now, this is Jesus still serving after the cross, after he rose from the dead, after he ascended into heaven, after he poured out his Holy Spirit. And even though you see Jesus here, guess who this is? This is you. And this is me. You see, Jesus is still serving everyone through your serving. And my serving. You know, just as Jesus did these things, you and I are doing these things as well. You know, this really hit home this week when, during the midst of this coronavirus pandemic, there was a group of people that gathered in our kitchen to put together meals. To put together prepackaged meals to help those who might need them during an economic downturn, might need them because they don't want to go out of their house, because they don't want to get sick, or they don't want to get others sick. It was great. They were serving meals, they were delivering them. But then it struck me. Isn't this what Jesus did? Didn't he sit on a hillside with his disciples? And they fed 5,000 people, not including the women and children there. He fed all those thousands of people. He gave them a meal. That's what's going on. That's what disciples of Jesus Christ get to do. They are serving others as God has gifted them in word, in deed. And it's Jesus continuing his service through them. However God has gifted you. However God has gifted you, you get to do the exact same things that Jesus does. You get to give sight to the blind by giving them Jesus. You get to help those who cannot hear to hear these wonderful words of love. You get to heal people. Yes, especially those who are doctors and nurses and surgeons. Boy, we're praying for them right now. But you also get to heal people by giving them Jesus. And yes, you get to proclaim the good news that Jesus himself proclaimed, the word of forgiveness, the word of life, and the word of salvation. And I pray, brothers and sisters in Christ, I pray that you don't just like doing this. I pray that you love to serve. I pray that you love to serve because you're not thinking about yourself anymore. You're not thinking about how you can be made great. That you're not thinking about how others can lift you up high. No. You're serving because Jesus has served you. He has given his life as a ransom to set you free. And he will continue to serve you with his love, his forgiveness, and his grace, and then continue that serving to everyone. Amen.
Yes, the love of God in Jesus Christ, giving his life for you and me, what an incredible service that he gives to us so that we can serve. What reckless love God gives to us in Jesus. So let's respond by singing his praises.
Thank you.
Let's pray to our Lord. Gracious Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for your Son, so thankful that he serves us, that he gives his life as payment to satisfy your wrath over our sins so that we can be set free from it, set free from death. We can have a new heart and a new life. So thankful for his service. It's when he humbles himself, it's when he stoops down, that he lifts us up, that he washes us clean of our sin, all through his word. And yet, Lord, when he lifts us up, it's to lift us up to serve, Lord. Lord God, we do pray that we receive the service of Jesus Christ, his love, his forgiveness, that we don't deserve, and then humbly find greatness in the kingdom of heaven by becoming a servant, by becoming slave of all, to serve others, Lord. Serve others in your name. Lord God, as you have gifted us, whether in word or deed, may we serve others, giving them Jesus, giving them his love, helping others out in need. Lord God, we are in the midst of trying times, unprecedented times, a global pandemic, Lord, that has people scared, has people afraid, has people, their entire lives have been disrupted by this, Lord, and now many are commanded, encouraged to stay at home to help prevent this spread. Lord Jesus, we ask that you bless those who are doing what they can, Lord. Prevent them from getting sick, Lord, those who are healthy. But we also pray for those who are sick, Lord. We pray for those who are sick with this coronavirus. Lord God, heal them according to your good and gracious will. Prevent the spread of this as much as possible, Lord. And Lord God, be with our medical personnel, doctors and nurses. They are dealing with just increasing amounts of this illness. Lord, be with them, Lord. May necessary supplies be given to them. And may there be healing, Lord. Be with them in this time. We're so thankful that they're on the front lines, Lord. Be with them. Continue to bless our government, our firefighters, our police, our leaders, Lord. Many of them have had to make tough decisions, Lord. Give them peace during this time. Give them wisdom and discernment. Be with those who are being hit hard with the economy, Lord. Lord God, may there be relief. May this be a time, Lord, in the midst of all this, that we truly realize that we have nothing, and that apart from your gracious hand, we have nothing. And that's why we ask, Lord, to give according to your good and gracious will. And be with your church during this time. Keep her faith strong. And Lord God, bless her in reaching out to others as they are able to, all while maintaining healthy choices, Lord. Lord God, there are other prayers on our hearts at this time. We lift them up to you. We lift them up, Lord, trusting in your mercy and your grace and your love in Jesus Christ, who has taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen."
Thank you.
know, during these trying times, we do want our faith to be strong. We have not been given a spirit of fear, but of faith, of power in the Holy Spirit. And that faith manifests itself in crying out to our God and confessing that this is our God who loves us. And so I now ask you to say, yes, even online, do you believe in God the Father, who gives you everything, who has created all things? And even though this world has been corrupted by sin, he is still taking care of it. He is still taking care of his creation. And do you believe that he will protect and defend you? And that it is our duty to thank and praise him? If so, then answer, I do believe.
I do believe.
And do you believe in his one and only Son, Jesus Christ, who did come to give his life as a ransom for many, so that you may be set free from sin, so that you may be set free from death, so that then you are now free to serve others, Christ's service going through you, and that this service will continue until he comes again on the last day? If so, then answer, I do believe.
I do believe.
And do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the one who gathers us by the gospel of Jesus Christ, the one who gives us faith in him through the good news that he is the one that gives his life so that we may live? And do you believe that you have forgiveness of sins? Do you believe that he will come again to judge, but will judge you righteous because of Jesus and what he has done for you? If so, then answer, I do believe.
I do believe.
Then may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace, now and forever. Amen. We're going to close our online 505 worship by singing a wonderful song of trust, a wonderful song of praise, 10,000 Reasons.
sin.